So first of all, thank you so much for this invitation back here to Bielefeld, my alma mater. You can't believe the amount of nostalgia I'm feeling right now. The only thing that has basically changed, last time I gave a lecture in Bielefeld, there were no microphones. Everything else is really overwhelming. So thank you so much. Again, the question is, will quantum computing disrupt machine learning? This is a bit of an exaggerated title. You'll see that throughout the presentation. Nevertheless, we will, of course, talk about machine learning and about quantum computing. So let's see how that goes. Why would we want to talk about machine learning? Why are you here? You're not alone. Look at this. These are data collected from Google Trends. That's a service provided by Google where you can enter query terms. And what you get back is not websites related to those query terms, but the amount of interest those query terms have generated over the past couple of years. That data goes back to 2004. What I have done here is I have entered machine learning and deep learning into Google Trends. And for machine learning, we see that has been around for a while. This is nothing new. There's nothing new under the sun. The term was first coined by Turing in the 1950s. But about here in 2012, 2013, something has happened, and global interest in machine learning began to rise or accelerate quickly. And then there is this other thing that has not been around forever. Basically, it did never generate any interest in the global population whatsoever. But again, about the same time, this term of deep learning begins to attract interest, and there's a lot of people in this auditorium today. So what has happened? What has happened with machine learning? This is what happened. In the last 10 years, and it really took off in about 2009, 2010, we have seen the confluence of four technological trends. And one could, of course, ask why these trends have not found together prior to that, and maybe the best answer is probably the time was not right back then. But in 2009, 2010, it was right. And what we have seen coming together is big data. That is nothing I have to tell you about. The world in 2019 is drowning in data. Robert Dijkgraaf had this chart yesterday where currently we have about 10 zettabytes of data available on the internet. And I remembered in 2011, so that is 8 years ago, I wrote a paper because in 2011 was the year where we entered the zettabyte age. In 2011, 8 years ago, for the first time there was one zettabyte of data available on the internet. Now, 8 years later, it is 10. So we are drowning in data. That's one of the trends. Affordable HPC stands for affordable high performance computing. Let me get that crosshair out of the way. There we go. Affordable high performance computing. Again, you may know that. These days, the graphics cards we use in our PCs traditionally to, you know, play games more fluently, those graphic cards are supercomputers in their own right, and they basically cost nothing. Then there is open source software. The internet is also a boon with respect to the exchange of technology, which is in this case computer code. So if you want to set up an AI system these days, you don't have to do that from scratch. Back when I studied here in Bielefeld, you know, we had to implement every single line of code from the beginning onwards. But nowadays, you can have access to numerous libraries other people have done. You can use them, and you don't have to start from scratch, which is another boost to this development. And then there is this, well, slightly technical term, something we call deep learning systems. Christian has already talked about that. Those four things together have led to this progress, current progress in artificial intelligence, have led to this global phenomenon of everybody being interested in AI and machine learning these days. Now, I wanted to say something about deep learning, and because I studied computer science and physics here in Bielefeld, I thought there might be a lot of computer science and physicists in the audience, so my presentation is slightly more technical than that of Christian. right? But or ever so slightly, but we'll get through that. What we see here is a mathematical model of a neuron, that is, of a nerve cell in the mammalian brains. And the way mathematicians, computer scientists, think about what such a neuron in a biological brain does is the following. We assume that there is a couple of inputs, which in our computers we always think about in terms of numbers. Everything in computers is numbers, and if it is rendered as a video on your screen or as your text declaration in the memory of the computer, that is numbers. And these numbers are being weighted by some other numbers. We just multiply this number, I call it x2, and this number, I call it w2, together. So we have a couple of weighted inputs, and they are then typically summed together, and then there is some crazy function that is applied to this sum of the weighted inputs, and that generates the output of this single individual mathematical neuron. And I have to say that this is a ridiculous idea for what's going on in the brain. This is a first-order scientific model of what's really happening. This has nothing to do with biology. But it turns out if we combine these simple computational units into larger systems, into larger architectures like these, they can do a lot of things. I have, put the deep in quotation marks. This is called a neural network because it consists of mathematical neurons. They are interconnected. They form a network. And the neurons in this sketch here are arranged in layers. And there are several layers. Should I stand still? Okay, good. There are several layers. And therefore, this is called a deep network. How is such a mathematical model, or basically a computer scientific architecture, able to learn? The question is, where do these weights come from? Right? And this is what happens in the so-called learning process. This is why we refer to these kind of techniques as models that are able to learn from data. Imagine you had lots of pictures of dogs and cats, and this is almost stereotypical by now, this example, but let's stay with dogs and cats. You have lots of pictures of dogs and cats. Each picture consists of many, many pixels, and you can arrange the pixels, like, I don't know, to be the input to this network. And then this network, using this here, computes something. And let's say if the picture you feed in shows a dog, then this output neuron here should fire, people like to call that. They produce an output of, I don't know, +1. And if it shows a cat, then this thing here should give an output of +1 and -1 otherwise, and so on. And you run this network, and very likely at the beginning it will, produce the wrong outputs. But as Christian explained, you can use this differential learning to ask yourself, well, if the output should have been dog, but it was cat, how would I have to adjust the weights in this layer of the network such that in the next run it becomes more likely to produce dog if there is a picture of a dog coming in, and to produce cat if there is a picture of a cat coming in? And how would I have then to adjust these weights of this layer in the network, and so on and so on? This is called backpropagation. And that's really, really what's at the heart of most neural learning methods, libraries these days. So the learning really is basically a fancy term for a mathematical process, namely the correct adjustment of a couple of many, many parameters in these crazy computational models. And this is just a sketch, because these days these things consist of hundreds of layers, and in each layer there is millions of neurons, but that would not have fit on the slide. So we have to stick with that. Now, what kind of problems can these fancy neural architectures solve? Well, basically, they are very good in pattern recognition. And over the last 10 years, we have seen dramatic breakthroughs in text understanding, image understanding, speech recognition, all of that. We've seen it in a video. Also influences robotics. Maybe you all know DeepL, and I'm preaching to the choir here, but this is what neural networks can do these days. Und they can learn to translate text from German into English. In diesem Vortrag betrachten wir künstliche Intelligenz und maschinelles Lernen, den aktuellen Stand der Technik und mögliche künftige Entwicklungen. The neural network turns that into, in this lecture we'll look at artificial intelligence and machine learning, the current state of the art and possible future developments. No human translator was involved in this translation. That has been done doing statistical learning exclusively. Here is an example of the kind of work we are doing at Fraunhofer, together with PricewaterhouseCoopers. These are pages taken out of a business report. If you are a publicly traded company, you have to frequently file business reports, and somebody has to read them, and somebody has to make sure that you do not behave fraudulently, so everything is correct in your business reports. These business reports are up to, 1,200 pages, whatever. People have to read them. Nobody likes to read that. And one question one could ask is, can we use machine learning, artificial intelligence to assist people in reading those reports, not to replace people? Right, but to assist them. For instance, could we use artificial intelligence informed by machine learning to find where within these 800 pages of text are the tables relevant for the question you are currently trying to answer? This is what sort of pre-learning AI would have returned, and this is what a learning system returns. So these things can actually learn to recognize structures in text and make sense out of very large texts. Here are examples from medicine. You can train these deep neural networks to perform medical diagnostics, and it turns out that in many cases, such as skin cancer recognition or so, these neural networks are way more reliable than medical professionals. And you might ask yourself, how is this possible? Well, let's do some math. Say you are a radiologist. You're looking at X-ray data, and you have to diagnose diseases or medical problems from looking at an X-ray image or fMRI or what have you. Well, if we are very generous, then you look at 100 images per day, which no radiologist does. That's an extreme exaggeration, but let's exaggerate. Let's say you work for 5 hours a week. That's somewhat more gentle for medical professionals. So then you would see, if you work 5 days a week, you would see 500 images per week. That makes, using 2 weeks of vacation, 25,000 images per year. And in a 40-year-long career, you would then have seen 1 million images. Really, the numbers are like that. 1 million images is a lot for a human to look at. But these machines, the data is available, are being trained with more than 10 million images. And from that point of view, statistically, it's actually no big deal that they are better in certain tasks where the human brain was not necessarily evolved for. What we are really good at is reading faces, body posture, these kind of things, jump up the tree if there's a tiger to the left of me. But there were no fMRI images 50 years ago. The magic is that the human brain is able to analyze them at all. So this, the excitement is not that the machines can do it slightly better than us. The excitement should be that we can do it at all, because we've not evolved towards analyzing fMRI images. However, and this is important, given all this excitement, and I give a lot of talks recently, I sort of have to straighten things up a bit, because we could now be tempted to think, well, everything is peachy and the future is glorious. We are not quite there yet. What we see here are results using computer systems, again, based on neural networks, and analyzing the content of images and automatically generating a caption for these images, such as, man in black shirt is playing guitar. This would have been unimaginable 10 years ago. This is unbelievable that things like these, girl in pink dress is jumping in air, that things like this can be done automatically these days. However, here we see a herd of sheep grazing on a lush green hillside. something has gone wrong. And to illustrate to you what it is that's going on here, we have to get back to the problem of bias. This is work done by Ribeiro et al., but I like the example. What we see here is a picture of a dog, a husky, that has been classified by a deep neural network as showing a wolf. That's certainly okay, because among all the dogs, the huskies really look a bit like wolves. But if we were really strict, that is a mistake nevertheless. Right? It should not have classified the dog as a wolf. So one could ask, what was it? And those of you who know this example, you have to be quiet for 30 seconds. Those of you who have never seen this before, tell me what you think the reason was for the neural network to classify this as a wolf. Was it the eyes, the snout, the fangs, the ears? What do you think? Chain. Well, it's actually shocking. It was this. It turns out that in the data that was used to train this neural network to recognize kinds of animals, there were a lot of pictures of giraffes and elephants and dogs and cats and wolves. But every picture that showed a wolf also showed snow. And from a purely statistical point of view, that is the reasonable decision to learn. If there is snow, then wolf. The description length, we call it, is minimal. Nobody in this room would have classified the content of that picture based on this part of the picture. Right? And you can actually force these deep neural networks to act stupidly. What we see here is a picture of a banana, obviously. And the neural network would actually classify that as a banana with 99% certainty. The remaining 1% is slug, Nacktschnecke. That's, you know, reasonable. But there's something that's called Google Deep Dream. You can run these networks backward. You can say, well, if the output should be toaster, how would the ideal input look like? And this is how it would look like. Now that I've told you that, you cannot but recognize this as a toaster. Isn't that fascinating? All right. Now that we all know that, yeah, this is sort of the prototypical toaster to this neural network, we can print it out or, you know, magically use GIMP or something like that, insert it into the picture of a banana, and now the neural network says, toaster. So those of you who are afraid of the Terminator scenario, Skynet, and so on, just print these things, pop them onto your forehead. You're safe. They will not take over anytime soon. All right? Now, it's good to know that there has been a lot of progress, and that this progress really, to a very large extent, is mainly in the area of pattern recognition. And that there is this problem of biased training data, which Christian talked about earlier. But we can ask, well, what else is there that has to do with intelligence? What about problem solving? And we are now entering the slightly more technical part of this presentation. Because, you know, this is Bielefeld, you should be knowledgeable about neural networks. What we see here is a sketch of something that is called a Hopfield network. A Hopfield network is a neural network, but it is a recurrent neural network. There is no direction of flow, say, from the bottom to the top, as we've seen earlier on those slides. But here there's a couple of neurons, and they are all interconnected. And if this neuron fires and produces an output of, say, +1, then that may change the state of the other neurons, which then again may change the state of that neuron. So there's back and forth and back and forth and back and forth between the activities or state values of those neurons. These are these synaptic connections, and again, I'm using this metaphor because everybody does so, but this has nothing to do with biology, and we have to impose certain requirements on the weights in these kind of recurrent neural networks. And if we impose these requirements, then we call this a Hopfield network. And for what I'm going to do in the next 10 minutes or so, we will assume that each neuron in such a Hopfield network produces an output of either minus one or plus one. So if we have seven neurons, then we have a collection of seven values of plus one and minus one that would represent the current state of this network. And at the next point in time, the outputs of the neurons may have flipped because, you know, they compute different activations at different points in time. So at the next point in time, we might have a different state vector collection of numbers of plus one and minus one. That would represent the overall state of this neural network. And one can then, and this is where we begin to build the bridge towards physics, define something that is called the energy of an Hopfield network. And mathematically, that would just be to say that it is somewhat, you know, let's talk science here. It's a quadratic form in the state vector. So we'll have the energy defined. I'm using H as minus 1 over 2 vector S transpose times matrix weight matrix W times vector S times vector theta transpose times state vector S. This is the vector of bias values of all these things in the neurons in this network. And one can prove, and this is very interesting about these Hopfield networks, this is actually a mathematical model that was proposed in the early 1980s, caused quite some excitement for about 5 years, and then people forgot about it because the excitement back then was in a direction and those networks are not really, really well suited for. But what is very interesting about these dynamical systems, where there's, you know, some change in the state of this system. For these Hopfield networks, one can prove that if the neurons update one at a time, not all at the same time, not simultaneously, but asynchronously, one at a time, then what is called the energy of the network can only go down. And because there's only finitely many configurations this network can be in, that means that one can prove that such a Hopfield network will eventually settle in a local minimum of the energy landscape. And that sounds a bit weak, and yes, it is, but it is a very strong statement when it comes to dynamical systems. For many, many more complicated dynamical systems than these ones, we cannot prove that. But for Hopfield networks, we can. And now it gets crazy. Let's, you know, really ask ourselves, what can such a Hopfield network do? It can recognize patterns. That was what got people excited in the early 1980s, but it does a very poor job in doing that. But it can also solve problems. But in order to understand what it means to say that a Hopfield network can solve problems, we have to widen our imagination as to what a problem is. I was struggling with myself. Should I bring a really hard problem where it's amazing to see that a Hopfield network can do it, but where the problem would be difficult to communicate because it is so difficult and mathematical? Or should I bring a really sort of, actually, excuse me, trivial problem that is so easy to explain that everybody is with me? I decided for the second option. Here is a problem. It is called the K-Rooks problem, and the problem is to place K, in this example, 4 rooks on a K by K, 4 by 4 chessboard, such that they do not threaten each other. This here would be a valid solution to this problem because none of the rooks are threatening each other. This one would not be a valid solution to this problem because these two things would threaten each other. Now, before I continue, let me really hit home that this is a trivial problem. How would we, as human beings with some degree of intelligence, solve that? We would probably, this is how I would do it, look at the first column and randomly pick a field, place a rook there. And that would tell us that in the second column, there's only 3 fields left for placing the rook. We randomly pick one. That would tell us that in the third column, there's only 2 fields left. We randomly pick one, and in the fourth column, it is deterministic. There's only 1 field left. We have to pick that. That's an algorithm. This algorithm has no emotion, whatever. You know, we just went through the notion of an algorithm for placing 4 rooks on a chessboard such that they don't threaten each other. So why would we want to have artificial intelligence or Hopfield networks to do that? There's no practical reason. This is just to show that these crazy architectures can do that as well, but they do so in a fundamentally different manner. And here it is. I define a certain weight matrix for this Hopfield network and a certain vector of bias values for the decision function. And my claim is that a Hopfield network where the energy function is defined like that would be able to place four rooks on the chessboard such that there is one rook per row. Using slightly different definitions for what we want to use for the weights and the bias values, we would have a Hopfield network that can place four rooks such that there is exactly one rook per column, and we can then combine them just by adding those two energy functions together, and we would end up with an energy function such that a Hopfield network that's trying to minimize this energy here would be able to solve the four rooks problem. Who in this room would solve the four rooks problem by minimizing that mathematical expression? Ah, I thought so. So, look at this. This is not a difficult problem. We went through an algorithm that a toddler in kindergarten could understand. But when we are talking about machine learning and artificial intelligence, we are sometimes required to rethink our approaches. And I have done just that. This is really crazy. Why would I want to do that? Right? But I can, here is proof. So on a 4x4 chessboard, there are, it's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, I can count the fields here. There's 16 fields. So a Hopfield network with 16 neurons should be sufficient to solve our problem. And if I start the network in a state where all the neurons are active, indicated by the pluses here, and then let this update mechanism run, we briefly mentioned earlier, you see that the state of the network evolves over time. Actually, you see that the energy never increases. Sometimes it remains constant from one step to the other, but it never goes up. And in this example, after 45 iterations, has found 53 iterations has found a configuration from where I've run it for 1,000 iterations. It doesn't change anymore. It has found a minimum of this crazy energy function, and if we understand every plus as put a rook here, then we see that first field, second field, third field, fourth field, put a rook there. Fifth, sixth, seventh, five, six, seven, put a rook there. And so on and so forth. So this state vector of the neural network encodes a valid solution to the problem we wanted to solve. Again, this is not a difficult problem. But there are problems that are much more difficult that could still be encoded this way. And let me point out that we have 16 neurons, which can have a value of plus one and minus one in the model we are considering here. So in total, there is 2^16 possible configurations for this network, which is 65,536. And out of these 65,536, only 24 configurations of the states of the neurons will represent a valid solution to our problem. So the question is, how do we find out of this humongous set of possibilities where to place rooks, how do we find those 24 needles, say, in the haystack? And what our network has done, it has found exactly one of these 24 possible solutions, because it's a simple problem. Okay, now then, what does that have to do with quantum computing? The future is already knocking on our doors. This here is the title page of The Economist from 3 years ago. And it was talking about quantum leaps, a mind-bending technology goes mainstream. And that was in early 2017 that I read it. Yeah. And I was alarmed because the last time I was tickled by the title page of The Economist, I remember that very vividly, was three years earlier, 2014, was on a trip to Berlin and read The Economist, and the title page, like the Technology Quarterly, The Economist, was all about machine learning. Right? And in between 2014 and 2017, it really all of a sudden was all about machine learning. So to me, it appeared that The Economist has a very good foresight team. And I took that as a warning. You know, if they now in 2017 talk about quantum technology, it's probably high time I, as a computer scientist, begin to worry about quantum computing. And I could, once again, because I studied here in Bielefeld, computer science and theoretical physics simultaneously. And indeed, turns out, you can by now buy quantum computers. Actually, Fraunhofer and IBM have teamed up. IBM will give us access to a quantum computer, which they will install here in Germany. These are pictures of machines produced by a Canadian company called D-Wave. And to the physicists in the room, I know that these are just quantum annealers, and we can really lovely have discussions after the presentations whether or not this is quantum computing. But to the machine learners in the room, if you understand this, you understand that. And that's, again, a decision I had to take. So I thought, well, let's, you know, talk more to the machine learners than to the physicists. I know that this is just quantum annealing, but it's exactly what the Hopfield network does. So these quantum computers produced by this Canadian company, D-Wave, are especially designed to solve problems like that. There is what they call a coupling matrix in physics, and a vector that models external influences to a system of n things, where each of these n things can be in a state of plus one and minus one. To the physicists, think about spins. But look at this. And then look at that. I just have to exchange the meaning of W and theta to get this. So honestly, if you understand Hopfield networks and the idea of energy minimization as an approach towards problem solving, you understand adiabatic quantum computing. And you actually do not have to understand all of this. It's nice if you do. It's nice if you do. And let me just briefly, you know, motivate what's happening here. Whereas in a digital computer, the fundamental object of interest is a bit, which can be in two states, either one of two states at a time, zero or one, we typically say. A quantum bit, and this is craziness, this comes from quantum mechanics, is in a superposition of two states simultaneously. And this is hard for our brains to accept because the light is either on or off. And in our macroscopic environment we live in, we don't see on-off light. It is either on or off, but if you were a subatomic particle, your friends would be on or off probably at the same time. We can use mathematics to understand the behavior of this quantum world. We can, in particular, also understand phenomena such as the superposition or entanglement, that the two quantum objects are not entirely independent of each other. We can use complex linear algebra to describe what's going on at that level of nature. Nobody knows why that works, but it works. Mathematics can do it. And we can describe a system of qubit to be in a superposition of, and this is because of superposition and entanglement, if we have n qubits, collectively, they will be in 2 to the n possible states at the same time. Crazy, I know, but this is just what they do. And we can sort of then describe the overall state of a qubit register as a linear combination of basis states, and these things here are called amplitudes. Those are complex numbers. Their absolute value has to sum to one. And if we look at a register of qubit and let it evolve under the influence of some operator called a Hamiltonian, where we think that this Hamiltonian itself is time-dependent, we can design the initial configuration for this Hamiltonian operator and the final configuration of this Hamiltonian operator, where to define the final Hamiltonian operator, we choose the formulation of our problem-solving problem to actually write this down, and we can then have this operator evolve from the initial form to the final form over some time capital T. And if we do that, this quantum system will evolve. What will change during this evolution is the value of these amplitudes of the basis states. And the value of those amplitudes itself is an indicator for how likely it is to measure a certain basis state. And if we do this for the Four-Rooks problem, right, I have already sort of shown you the matrices we need there to solve that, and then use a quantum system, an adiabatic quantum computing system, to solve the Four-Rook problem. What we see is, initially, all the 65,000 plus possible solutions are equally likely. The system is in a superposition of those. But with time, the amplitudes of some of the possible solutions rise up, and the amplitudes of others of the possible solutions go down. And if we look at the state of this quantum system after some time, we'll find that there is 24 states that are more likely than the others. And here they are. And this one is the 25th. I'm just showing it to show that the probability amplitude for the first 24 things here is all the same. Those are these three things. And if you look at these qubit registers here, you can probably recognize that, yeah, they encode a valid solution to the Four-Rook problem. And now we just have to measure that. And then with high probability, one of these will pop out of the quantum computer. Here, I did this in a numerical simulation on a digital computer. And we have found a solution. And the magic here is, I shouldn't use the word magic in a scientific lecture. The interesting thing is that whereas the Hopfield network finds exactly one solution using the quantum computer, we get 24 solutions simultaneously, and then sort of by measuring the system, get one out of them for good. But that is what makes quantum computing very interesting. Sort of, it simultaneously is able to look at all the possible solutions, good or bad, and the good ones over time in this approach here become more likely, and therefore more likely to come out of the machine once we ask it for the solution. All good solutions are found simultaneously. And that is really, for the Four-Rooks problem, this is a triviality, but we can all understand the Four-Rooks problem. We can now see that quantum computers can solve intelligence problems. And they do that much faster than digital computers would do, in particular because they look at all possible solutions simultaneously. That is where the magic, where the power lies. And to conclude this presentation, here's two key messages you have to take home from this. At this point right now, society simultaneously under and overestimates how machine learning will impact economy, societies, politics, and so on. And again, starting now in 2019, with the reports coming out of Google last month, people simultaneously under and overestimate how quantum computing will impact all of this, because they tell me, yeah, but these are just lab prototypes. In the 1940s, digital computers were just lab prototypes. And now look at the world we are living in. Right? So being overly critical and being overly excited are both dangerous positions to be in these days in the information age. Thank you very much.